Good afternoon, everyone. This is Mike Romali here with the Hurricane Outlook and Discussion for June 3rd, 2021, recorded on 1:47 p.m. Eastern Time. Taking a wide look across the tropical Atlantic this afternoon, all is quiet for this 3rd of June, as we would expect this time of the year. Watching this one tropical wave coming off of Africa that is fairly strong at the moment, fairly robust, but it is moving into drier conditions. You can see all this very dry Saharan air across the main development region at this time. And that is to be much expected for this time of the year. Again, it's just simply not ready yet for tropical cyclone activity. And elsewhere across the region, kind of being dominated by this big Bermuda high over here. And we can see the return of showers and thunderstorms across most of Florida at the moment. Scattered showers and thunderstorms and all the way up and towards the northeast, where they have a risk for severe storms today out across that general area. Looking here at the sea surface temperature anomaly map, last updated as of yesterday, June 2nd. Again, not much has changed over the last several days, but we continue to monitor the waning La Nina conditions. In fact, La Nina has officially come to an end across the equatorial Pacific. And we turn our attention to what may be happening later in the season. We'll talk about that here in a moment. But one interesting thing that we've been kind of keeping our eyes on is this cooler blob out here off the coast of California and the Baja Peninsula. And what this really does here, more than anything, this spatially limits the hurricanes and tropical cyclones in the eastern Pacific. It kind of cuts off a great deal of ample moisture supply and instability supply for convection, upward moving air, etc. And because of that, you don't have a lot of convection over this area. And because of that, because this area is shut down, we should start to see the Atlantic Basin in turn take over and become the dominant basin by, you know, August, September, October. And for that reason, kind of all of that points towards, okay, this being another above average hurricane season, more than likely. And again, there's a lot of things that support that. Now, if we look here at the ENSO state, and this is the probabilities coming from the CPC and the IRI Institute Research, I believe. And this is for early May, so June hasn't been released yet. But we can see that we are under, of course, 50% La Nina odds. La Nina has ended. And we can see that even the potential for any El Nino conditions really has no merit here. About, what, you know, 5% chance of any El Nino, and it stays below, you know, that 10% threshold. And La Nina odds actually increased to slightly above 50% by December, January, and February. By August, September, October here, again, highlighted by this black arrow, there's about a 50% chance that we are at neutral conditions. So El Nino probably not happening, and there's nothing going to be stopping this from kind of kicking back and saying, oh, you know, we're not going to have a busy hurricane season. There's nothing that's going to pop up like that. So there's nothing stopping this hurricane season in this department. And furthermore, again, kind of something that we really need to pay attention to, and this is one of the things that has to kind of be understood. So what we're looking at here is, of course, El Nino conditions are over here in this territory. La Nina conditions are here in that territory, divided on either side by the 0.5 Celsius, which is La Nina or El Nino, respectively, those thresholds. Now, a few models are indicating that we touch into warm neutral. And again, this goes all the way back through April here. So a few models were indicating that we jump into warm neutral by the peak of the hurricane season, which is right here, this black arrow. There's also a lot of models, and the majority of them, that indicate we are in a cool neutral by this time. So given that, we don't really have too much model support for a significant El Nino. We don't really have any besides like two models. We have a lot more models indicating that on either side, we either end up with a warm or cool neutral. And the most likely outcome will be a cool neutral by the time we get into August, September, and October. And that's very important because a cool neutral is a little bit more conducive for hurricane activity in the Atlantic Basin. And because of that, this is the June 3rd Colorado State University Outlook released today. 18 named storms, that already includes Anna that formed, back in May. So we're really left with 17 additional named storms. We still have 8 hurricanes to go and 4 major hurricanes. And that's very important because, again, you know, you don't need, 17 named storms to wreak havoc. All you need is one named storm coming down your neighborhood, and that is your bad day. And again, the accumulated cyclone energy is about 150, and it ranges. There's a big range here. Again, these are just more of the kind of actual numbers, but the range goes from about 83 all the way up to about 223, which is a 2017 repeat. So there's kind of a 2006 where you don't really get a lot, but we ended up with a warm neutral that year for the ENSO state, kind of like a small El Nino. And in the case of 2017, we ended up with a very warm Atlantic Basin, and we don't really have either of that right now. So again, 150 ACE index, that seems pretty reasonable. 9 major hurricane days, 35 hurricane days. So of course, we're all above average in every single category. We're well above average in every single category. Again, this is using the new averages from the 1991 through 2020 climatology. So that's kind of looking at all the newest parameters. So we're a little bit below hyperactive, but we are at an above average season nonetheless. Now, what's going on out there right now? Well, fortunately for us, nothing really is going on. The 2 p.m. outlook from the National Hurricane Center has absolutely nothing over the next several days. However, we will be watching an area that could potentially try to develop from a Central American gyre out here in the Eastern Pacific Basin, and we'll look at that here in just a moment, or really across Central America. In the Eastern Pacific or the Caribbean, we could see one or two systems try to develop, and we'll talk about that here in just a moment. Real quickly, looking at the Gulf sea surface temperatures across the region, again, we continue to monitor how quickly this area to the north is kind of warming up. And right now, the rest of the Gulf Basin is certainly more than supportive for tropical cyclones. You can see this 28-degree isotherm, which is lines of constant temperature, all the way through about 27 degrees north. And that is a fairly large expanse of air. You can kind of see the window for most opportune tropical cyclone formation, and certainly more greater sea surface temperatures, remain south of about 27 degrees north. Anywhere above that still, water temperatures are about 26 Celsius and some even, 25 Celsius in through there. But as I alluded to over the last several days, all you need is a tropical cyclone to maybe come out, let's just say, over the Caribbean and rapidly advect towards the north. And we saw this, time and time again. We saw this a couple of times last year. These faster moving tropical cyclones on approach like Delta, they didn't really have a lot of time to weaken in the cooler shelf waters out here. Water temperatures in the Louisiana region were already stirred up, but they were, minimal. They were, 26, 27 Celsius and didn't really support, a really intense, Category 2, Category 3 hurricane. Well, if you get a really intense, well-organized system that is able to develop and rapidly move northward, you're not going to have a lot of time to induce a lot of downwell or a lot of upwelling, rather. And that would be certainly something that would favor tropical cyclones being able to maintain their intensity on approach to land. And furthermore to that point, this is the upper ocean heat content values updated as of this morning. And again, like we talked about yesterday, anywhere here from the lighter blue values onward on the scale going towards the right here, this is increasing upper ocean heat content. This is basically tropical cyclone heat potential and the potential for tropical cyclones to intensify within the waters. And again, a tropical storm, hurricane, whatever, it upwells cooler water. And this is the 26-degree isotherm at depth. So all this really does is it draws up warmer waters. And that's kind of what this heat potential map is really showing. And again, these yellows here, these kind of brighter yellows and brighter greens, and then even these oranges, orange colors, this indicates that there's fairly high upper ocean heat content in the Caribbean. And this goes to suggest that if we do get anything to develop down here in this region, that not only would the water temperatures be warm enough, but there's sufficient depth of the warm waters to support a tropical storm or potentially even a hurricane down there. And most of the central Gulf of Mexico, most of the central and southern Gulf of Mexico too, across this area, has sufficient upper ocean heat content values. And you can see that even some of these lighter greens showing up here in this warm eddy. And again, that goes to suggest that if we did have anything coming up here, late June, July, whatever, that there's going to be a lot of heat potential for there to kind of work with, for these systems to work with as they move from the Caribbean to the Gulf of Mexico, especially in that warm eddy that is located right about here. And again, this has implications because if you get a system that, let's just say, comes in, the Florida Panhandle, the Big Bend, or comes into the Florida Peninsula, potentially heads up, over here to, either Louisiana or Texas, it has a lot of time to deal with warmer waters. And assuming that it's not a really fast moving system, or even if it is, it still has that warm water to kind of feed off on. So it's very important to kind of understand, just because the sea surface temperatures are not really too warm across the shelf waters, this is water that is easily mixable and will likely warm. The Gulf Basin is always warm enough by the peak of the hurricane season for intense tropical cyclones, undoubtedly, and that will be a guarantee again later this year. So we'll just have to see. Moving forward, though, this is the GFS forecast, the 6E run, valid for 2 p.m. this afternoon, so here in about a minute. Again, we're watching a large expanse of high-pressure regions sitting over Bermuda, basically, and that is just pumping a lot of deep tropical moisture out across the southeastern United States and all the way up here into the northeast, where there's a threat for severe storms today. So kind of a large plume of tropical moisture that kind of originates all the way down here, that kind of moves through the Caribbean and the Western Atlantic, and then finally kind of ends up over here. So we have a large plume there, and again, not really much going on. We do have the intertropical convergence zone that's pretty far south, and again, some of that area of vorticity here in the eastern Pacific, but we'll move this forward out in time and just kind of give you a general idea in terms of what could happen. Now, the GFS is indicating that we may see yet another tropical cyclone try to develop here in the eastern Pacific, really within the next about 96 hours or so. And that's definitely feasible. The National Hurricane Center did highlight that area in the 2 p.m. outlook for the Eastern Pacific Basin. So that is something that we'll definitely have to keep in mind. But as of right now, there's no reason to be worried across the, California, or not the California, but the Central American and Mexico coastline and the Baja of California. Nothing to really be worried about at the moment. But we start to turn our attention beyond that time. And it's really beyond about day five, where we can start to see, if you kind of just play this back here, you notice how there is some cyclonic turning in the atmosphere down here near Central America and obviously Honduras in that area. And you can kind of see this broad fetch of winds kind of coming together in a, kind of counterclockwise fashion. And this is a Central American gyre, and these Central American gyres are often known to produce copious amounts of rainfall across portions of Central America, and they have obviously been known and known for mainly producing tropical cyclones in the eastern Pacific or the Atlantic side. And over the last several years, we've been favoring the Atlantic side for development out of these Central American gyres, really over the past, 4 or 5 years or so. And this is kind of even further indicated. We look here at the shear values from the 6E GFS. We kind of move out here and we notice that there's an area of relatively lighter shear in this area across the east, or really across portions of the eastern Pacific, then over near Central America and the western, really kind of the western Caribbean. There's lesser shear values in this area during that time. And again, the GFS continues to kind of try to indicate that we do end up getting something to develop down here in this region, at least in the way of a broad cyclonic vorticity area. And these Central American gyres, not only, like I said, do they produce very copious amounts of rainfall, which obviously is not really a good thing because it leads to mudslides, flash flooding, and unfortunately can lead to loss of life. But they have been known to develop tropical cyclones, and the modeling often does a very poor job of resolving these Central American gyres because it's very hard for the modeling to kind of pick up on that. So with that being said, we kind of look towards other things in the signals. And one of the things that we look for is the shear values. And again, with the shear values being lighter, that does indicate that there is some potential. And even furthermore, this is the sea level pressure anomalies, the mean sea level pressure anomalies off the GFS ensembles. And we'll run this forward here over the next several days. And what you'll notice is that after really about day five, you'll start to notice that we get a lowering in the pressures out here, mainly across the entire Atlantic Basin. We notice that in the main development region of the Atlantic Basin, we have lower than normal pressures. So trade winds will be lighter, possibly allowing the Atlantic to warm further. And then in the Gulf of Mexico and the Caribbean, we start to notice that there is a lowered pressures in this region. And if we move this out even further, these pressure anomalies become darker, which means that there is a lower pressure anomaly. And this goes all the way down to -9 on the anomalies. And, you know, if you get on either side, you know, -9, you know, this is really probably about -7. But that is some fairly strong, correlation saying that, hey, this has the potential for something to kind of go down in that vicinity. So we'll be watching over the next several days and to kind of corroborate that on the GFS mean sea level pressures. Again, we continue to run this forward here. And really it's about after day five where we start to notice that there becomes kind of these areas that we might be watching in the Gulf of Mexico. Now, again, it's too early to determine what, if anything, may develop. This is well beyond 5 days. But we do start to see even some consistency from the Euro ensembles as well, the Euro mean ensembles, that there is something that we'll have to watch down here, whether it be for Central America and Mexico, or whether it be across into the Atlantic Basin, for the Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico. So there's something, you know, to kind of watch over the next several weeks. Again, nothing guaranteed, but we'll be watching over the next several days for what could potentially develop on either side of the Eastern Pacific or the Atlantic Basin. So we'll be watching that, but again, no real concern at the moment. Hey, look, that's pretty much all we have for today. Channel memberships are live. If you are interested in that, click the join button. And links will also be down in the description down below if you guys do want to support the channel. All right. That being said, hope you all have a great rest of your afternoon and evening. Of course, I am Mike Romelli. I'll talk to you guys again some more tomorrow.